Probably if I was in a stable foster home and got the feeling of what it meant to have a home, I probably wouldn't be sitting here in prison right now.
When you're foster parent and if you get a kid, you got to understand what their problem is before you go judging them and how they act and everything, because they got a lot of problems. That's why they go into a foster home.
I don't know if we're different. I think that maybe we just have, we love kids. And I think that that's probably the basic thing that most people who take foster children is they really love kids.
Home, it is something we all take for granted. It's supposed to be filled with a mother, a father, and two happy children. But all too often, it doesn't work out that way. What happens when home disintegrates and a parent's worst nightmares are realized? They can't care for their own children. Tonight, a special report on foster care in Massachusetts.
Tonight, Mary, we're going to look at the foster care system, but more importantly, at the people affected by it. The children who have to be removed from their natural homes, and the people who take them in. We'll also examine some of the controversy surrounding the Department of Social Services, the state agency set up to deal with children at risk. And Andrea Hall is standing by live tonight at the Roxbury Comprehensive Health Center. Andrea? Okay, having a little problem with Andrea's mic. She's going to be talking a bit later on with Dr. Ben Nolan. He's a clinical psychologist who specializes in children. Should children be returned to their natural homes, even if the home has had a history of problems, or should they be left in foster care? We'll be talking with Dr. Nolan about that when we go back to Andrea. And we'll talk live with Secretary of Human Services Philip Johnston and with Children's Advocate Jetta Bernier of the Mass Committee for Children and Youth. First, though, we're going to take you inside the home of a unique couple who've been taking in foster children for more than 30 years. They say they're not saints. You might disagree.
People I was living with, they always kept us outside, and it was like 10 degrees out, you know, and they make us stay outside, and if you know, and then you'd sneak inside, you know, to get warm, and they tell you you couldn't have any supper, you know. I really didn't like it.
I never had food on a table, say, for instance. And I never had a TV, radio, never had love before.
Most of us tend to take home for granted. This isn't the case with the over 6,000 children placed in foster care in Massachusetts. These are children with complex needs and problems, children who often haven't had all the love they're entitled to. For over 30 years, Peggy and Bob Schofield have taken in foster children. They've opened their home and their hearts to them. They will be the first to tell you it isn't always easy, but both agree the rewards are worth it.
You do bend over backwards. You do make allowances, but you cannot allow yourself to be manipulated.
Peggy Schofield knows better than most. Over the past three decades, she and Bob have taken in more than 30 foster children and gone on to adopt five of them. One is Alicia, now 17 years old. Alicia has gone through a tremendous amount of change since she arrived 6 years ago. This was her third placement, after her own mother couldn't care for her.
I was angry at the world, and I felt a lot of pain. And I didn't want anybody to like me, and I didn't want to like anybody.
She didn't want to be here. She'd rather be anyplace else. She would rather be home. But she could not be home.
Well, I just wanted to fool around and get in trouble in school and go out with friends.
Once you can explain to Alicia that this is the way it is, there are choices to be made. The choice that her parents made was their choice. It was no reflection on Alicia.
You know, as much as I hated, it all turned to love because of what was given to me.
Foster parents deal often with damaged children. Peggy and Bob have experienced everything from stealing to extreme hurt and anger. Heidi, another foster child, says it's not surprising new children tend to act out.
When you're foster parent and if you get a kid, you got to understand what their problem is before you go judging them and how they act and everything, because they got a lot of problems. That's why they go into a foster home.
You just love them. You have to love them enough to let them express all that anger and all that hate
Foster parents have to cope with the normal strains of growing up and also the emotional scars that many foster children arrive with. Their son, Alan, had been physically abused.
I can't recall which one it was that I was given a hossyback ride on my shoulder.
That was Alan.
You know, and unconsciously, I just swing him around on my back, put him on my shoulders, and start walking either up or downstairs, wherever we happen to be going. And there was panic in his heart and body. You could feel it while he was on your shoulders. Unbelievable.
Why was that, Bob?
Because he was beaten and afraid that I was probably going to toss him against the wall or something.
Georgette was extremely fragile during her early years with the Schofields, and for good reason. She'd also been a victim of abuse.
She surprised all of us with the strength in that tiny little thing.
She's quite a lady.
Yeah, she is quite a lady. But to be able to go to court the way she had to and to go before the grand jury the way she had to, she has a lot of backbone, that little girl.
That little girl has grown into a mature young woman who's mapped out her future as an artist.
You can make it out there if you want to. A lot of people don't think they can. But if you really try, you really think that you can do it.
I bet you that snake's frozen in here. And that snake is caught in there?
There is a severe shortage of foster parents. Some blame it on the meager compensation given to families. They receive only $11.49 a day for living expenses and another $68 a quarter for clothing.
Foster parents do not take children just to get paid. And the financial responsibility that you assume also as a foster parent can be offset in some regards, but not in regards to the clothing.
Can somebody push this rope?
Perhaps the most difficult part of being a foster parent is letting go. Peggy Schofield always said she would not take in younger children because it was too heart-wrenching when they went home. However, Timmy, Christina, and Jean arrived the day after Christmas.
You have two houses, right?
Yep. Two houses with two dads, two dads and two mothers.
You like that?
Yep, but my daddy ain't living at my house.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know where he's living again.
The philosophy of DSS, as you know, is that the biological family should be preserved and that these kids should go back to the biological family. Do you agree?
There are times when the foster parent part of me gets in the way, but then the biological part of me says, they've got to go home. And again, foster parents really don't have any rights. We have to learn to love with open arms. You do all the loving and then you let go.
If you had a magic wand and you could make any change in the system you wanted, what would you do?
When a child is up for adoption or legal guardianship, I'd love to see that red tape cut.
Alicia waited almost 6 years before the Schofields could become her legal guardian.
I just thought maybe they didn't want me to get adopted or something. You know, I didn't understand why. It made me angry.
Meanwhile, Heidi still waits.
My mother really didn't want to sign the papers, but I don't know if it doesn't go, if I don't get it this year, she's going to deny that she even signed the papers, you know, and go to court and fight it all over again.
They don't do it for the money, and it can be painful at times. What makes Bob and Peggy Schofield foster parents?
It really makes you stop and think life is very good, and things can be very right with the world.
We'll be back with the heart-wrenching case of a foster family fighting to keep their 4-year-old and the biological family that wants him back. And we'll be talking with a woman who came to symbolize everything that was wrong with foster care in Massachusetts.
A child can end up in foster care. Either the parents won't be able to deal with them for one reason or another, and they will place them there voluntarily, or a child can be taken away from those parents by a court order. In either case, foster care is supposed to be temporary, with the child being returned to the biological parents as soon as possible. Occasionally, though, foster parents may go on to adopt that foster child, but this is not the purpose of the system. And sometimes the foster family and the biological family want that child. That's what happened in the case of Patricia and Cleveland Riddick.
Now, for 3.5 years, they've been telling us we're going to be able to adopt Michael. And then on July 11th, they come and tell us they're going to take Michael. So today, they're telling us that they're going to think about it.
This child has not been released for adoption, has never been released for adoption, and will not be released for adoption by my client.
The Riddicks seem to think he was, though. Someone told them that.
I don't know who told them that, and I don't know what their source of information is. It is inaccurate.
How do you feel this morning, Ted?
I'm nervous, and I'm scared, and I don't want to lose my son. And we're going to do everything we can to keep him.
Patricia and Cleveland Riddick are terrified of losing their four-year-old foster child, Michael. The child they raised since he was 6 days old. The child they say they were told they could adopt.
The foster parent says, I've had this child for, you know, X number of months or X number of years. And the parent says, but this is my child, and I have certain rights relative to that child. And, you know, you've got an agency in the middle, you've got a court in the middle.
And that's exactly where the Riddick case is now, here at Suffolk Probate Court. Because a gag order is in effect, we don't know very many specifics about the case, but here's what we do know. Sources tell us that little Michael's biological mother was troubled. To what degree, we're not sure. Yet troubled enough, we're told, that when she found herself pregnant, she went to DSS to arrange temporary foster care for her child. And that's where Patricia and Cleveland Riddick came in. For 3.5 years, they raised Michael as if he were their own child.
4 years ago, what were your feelings when you first brought the child home?
I came home, I had a baby. I had to sit down and they made me a cup of tea. They did.
But raising Michael wasn't always easy.
He had a few problems at first. I mean, he was concussed and he was walking floor for hours of the night. He was crying all night and he couldn't pass his bowels and all that.
How'd that make you feel to see him suffering like that?
Sad, because I didn't know what to do for him. You know, we just tried to comfort him the best we could. Finally, he outgrew it.
The Riddicks have had all the joy and pain that go along with raising a child. They hoped one day he would be their child.
I was adopted. I learned about my adoption when I was 13. I know all about the system. I've been through it. Foster homes, institutions waiting to go to foster homes.
Do you think you were any worse the where because you were adopted?
No, I'm the better. I'm the better.
And the Riddicks felt that adoption for Michael would be the best thing as well.
A foster child is different. We never wanted to be foster parents for the simple reason a foster parent doesn't keep a child. It's a revolving child. It goes constantly. The child is here for this amount of time and is gone. So this is what we wanted, and we made it specifically clear. We were not a foster home. We are an approved adoptive home.
However, as Attorney Elder has repeatedly stated, Michael's biological family never intended for him to be adopted, a position she says was made perfectly clear to the Department of Social Services. Who's to blame for the confusion over Michael's future? Is there something wrong with the system? Where did communications break down? Why did the Riddicks think they could adopt Michael? And why does the natural mother's attorney say otherwise? And most importantly, how will the decisions now being made in Suffolk Probate Court affect little Michael's future well-being?
I know it's something you don't want to think about, and you constantly place it in the back of your mind, but what happens if you lose this fight?
I'll never believe it. There's got to be, whoever makes the decision, they got to have some kind of heart. I mean, they just got to understand that there's a lot of love here, and you just can't throw away all your life. I'll never believe that they'll never, that I won't win. I really won't believe that.
And you're
going to
fight?
I'll fight to the end.
We are live now here at the Roxbury Comprehensive Medical Center, where Dr. Ben Nolan is the Director of Mental and Social Health. He's also a clinical psychologist specializing in children. Thanks for being with us, Dr. Nolan. I know we can't talk about specifics because there is a gag order in effect about this case, but let's generalize. What would you say is the general consensus among the psychiatric community regarding a situation in foster care like this one?
Basically, I guess the psychiatric, psychological community's position is that there should be consistency of care for the child, that attention should be placed on the bonding kind of issues that occur in the parent-child relationship. And I think that the psychiatric community would say that in the case where the child is removed temporarily from the home, that we should try to get them back to their family as soon as possible.
Okay, so what I hear you're saying is, in conjunction and along the same lines as the Department of Social Services policy, which is place these children back with their natural families as soon as possible. Mm-hmm. There is a different case, though, when we're talking about something like the Riddick case. What happens to a four-year-old psychologically if he is taken away from the family setting that he has basically known all his life and placed with strangers?
Okay. There is not really a biological bonding as much as there is a psychological bonding. Mm-hmm. By that I mean the child at birth and on up to, you know, later on in his development is not really concerned with biological attachment. He's much more involved psychologically with those people who give him care. In other words, he really looks much more towards, how do these people take care of me? How do they respond to me? Do they love me? Do they provide me with security? All of those kinds mm-hmm. of things enables the child to form a psychological bonding, a psychological attachment.
Right.
And that's what happened in the Riddick case.
That's what happened in the Riddick case. And of course, we can only wonder what might happen if little Michael is taken out of that setting. We should point out that at no point in time, the fact that the Riddicks are an interracial couple came into play with this case. That is not an issue here. And the Department of Social Services states that they are, in fact, a good foster care family. When I posed that question to Mrs. Riddick, if there were a problem with them being interracial, she said this to me. She says, we have no black and white in our home. Everyone is welcome in our home, and everyone is treated fairly. And we can only hope that little Michael will be treated fairly when this is all said and done. Coming up next, an interview with Denise Gallison. After a message, stay with us.
The average length of stay in the Massachusetts foster care system is now 2.5 years. Every year, one out of every three foster children returns home.
Since 1980, the Department of Social Services has overseen foster care services in Massachusetts. But what about before 1980? Foster care in the 19th century began as a way to help homeless children wandering the streets with nowhere to go. And it ended as an agency deep in trouble.
It started, my husband was drinking. He had been drinking all day. And my daughter had been sick with a cold. And so I was taking her out to the kitchen to clean her up. And my husband said, you care more about her than you do me. And we started arguing. So he pushed her. She went flying into the chair and whacked her head. I asked my husband to help me, so he tried to. But it didn't do no good. She was already dead.
In 1978, Denise Gallison was convicted of manslaughter in connection with the death of her 3-year-old daughter, Jennifer, and sentenced to serve 18 to 20 years here at MCI Framingham. But tragic as it was, the death of Jennifer Gallison was not in vain. Public outrage over the Gallison case and several others like it, which surfaced in the late 1970s, was so great that it forced the Commonwealth to make some dramatic changes. The state soon moved to completely reorganize its services to families and children at risk. Denise was a classic case of the Massachusetts foster care system. She had been a ward of the state for 15 years. During that time, she was placed in 11 foster homes and institutions. Both Denise and her children are victims, victims of being pushed through a system ill-equipped to handle their needs. A system that from the beginning was marked by good intentions and tragic results. In 1853, Charles Loring Brace of the New York Children's Aid Society established the first program for placing children in substitute care. Previously, those children lived in almshouses or poorhouses, but public outcry led to another approach. Homeless children were taken from eastern cities and relocated in the sparsely settled Midwest. The wholesomeness of farm life was considered good for them. Although some children were placed in good homes, others were not, and the wholesomeness of country life turned into long hours of heavy labor, and once again stories of abuse and neglect became common. By the 1880s, Charles Burtwell of the Boston's Children's Aid Society monitored foster parents by instituting formal home studies, home visits, and the investigating of references. At the turn of the century, the nation had a very clear picture of the problems connected with child care. In 1930, the White House Conference on Children and Youth developed a children's charter. It says every homeless child has an unshakable right to foster parents, and that each is entitled to the love and security a home provides. By the 1950s, the federal government's responsibility for child welfare services had grown dramatically, but many communities still lacked the basics. Virtually no services were available to biological families after a child had been placed in foster care. In the 1960s, child abuse jumped into the national consciousness, bringing new pressure to get kids out of abusive homes and into foster care. It wasn't until much later that the public learned, to its horror, that some foster homes were just as abusive, or worse, than the biological ones. And the state bureaucracy couldn't cope with families in crisis. In the late 70s, the death of Jennifer Gallison and the Nassar and Devana child abuse cases were a constant reminder that the system was overloaded.
A welfare commissioner, and then you had an assistant commissioner for social services who was in charge of foster care, but who did not have a direct line authority over the field staff. And so there was always some question as to who was in charge.
Six different agencies were responsible for delivering social services to children in Massachusetts. It was a complex and frustrating system that often made things worse for the people it was trying to help.
And I believe that the legislation finally passed only because of one of the worst child abuse tragedies that we've had in the history of the state, the death of a little girl named Jennifer Gallison, who died during the blizzard in February of 1978.
And so, on June 1st, 1979, Mary Jane England was appointed as commissioner of the Department of Social Services. Her job, to launch a new department, which would assume responsibility of foster care from the Department of Welfare. The department's philosophy has three primary principles: to contribute to the stability of the family, not replace it; to reach out into the community and encourage families to seek help voluntarily; and that services be responsible to consumer needs. There are still serious gaps in the state services for children. Marie Matava, current commissioner of the Department of Social Services.
Are we doing everything that anybody might expect us to do? No, we're not. Are we trying to take those pieces that we think are most important and do them well? I think yes, we are.
As you have just seen, the death of Jennifer Gallison was so shocking that it led to a total reorganization of children's services in Massachusetts. Jennifer's mother, Denise, was a product of the old foster care system. Denise Gallison, who is scheduled to be released from MCI Framingham next month, would not talk to us about the death of her daughter. She did talk about the foster care system she knew and her ideas on what might prevent another tragedy like the death of her daughter.
Denise, tell us about your experiences in foster care, both good and bad.
Well, the good part was being a part of family. I stayed with one for about a year. They were really good to me. And then all of a sudden, the foster mother became ill and I had to move.
And what was the worst experience? What were the bad experiences?
The bad experience was never staying in one place long enough to know what being apart really means of a family. My brothers and my sisters went to a foster home, and they just left me in that orphanage. They just separated us.
Had you been close to them? Did you feel like you'd lost the last thing that you could hang on to?
Yes, I did. It was like I was losing a part of me.
Denise, what effect did getting moved around so often and not having a stable household have on you as a child?
probably if I was in a stable foster home and got the feeling of what it meant to have a home, I probably wouldn't be sitting here in prison right now.
What was wrong with some of the families?
Well, some of them would, you know, sexually abuse me, physically abuse me, and some of the people just did it for money.
Now, when you were little, you didn't know to be angry at the state or the government. Who did you think was running your life?
All I knew was this one social worker that would come and say, "Hello, Denise, want to talk to me for a while?" And I'd always run.
If you could give any message to foster parents, what would you say to them?
Well, if anybody decides to become a foster parent, please remember to give them the love and understanding that you would give your own, and let them know that they're wanted so that they don't grow up in constant fear of what might hold for them in the future. We need more foster parents to help these children and who really care about them. Because I wouldn't want what happened to me happen to them.
A little later in the program, we'll be talking with a man responsible for administering foster care, and we'll meet some hard-to-place youngsters. Stay with us.
In 1985, approximately 50,000 children were reported abused or neglected. If you have information about a child being mistreated, please call the Child at Risk Hotline, 1-800-792-5200.
Whether it's adoption or foster care, it's easy to place a happy, healthy young child. But older children, or children with special needs, are another story. Fully half of the kids in today's foster care system are adolescents. Some special needs children and adolescents live in group homes. Others need a more intensive one-to-one placement. Here's the story of two of them.
I imagine, you know, I dream of going back home to my family. Rather than just going there on the weekends or limited amounts of time. I imagine going back there and having fun and playing with the dog. That's what I really would like to do, is go back home.
Home is a dream, not a reality, for Michelle Almeida. 5 years ago, the state removed her from her home after charges of abuse, charges Michelle's family denies. Cheryl Correa says the state's action made her troubled daughter worse.
I was the closest person to her, the only one, her main caretaker that she had always been with, and it really ruined her. I saw an abrupt change in her behavior.
Michelle spent the next few years in and out of different foster homes. No placement seemed to work.
The communication was so difficult for me. There were no deaf families that I was placed with. That would be much better for me.
Today, life is much better for Michelle. She has found community and communication at the Hayden School in Dorchester.
They've made her understand herself and some of her problems and her frustrations and why she did a lot of the acting out. They've taught her to control it and express herself.
The Hayden Program for Deaf Children with Behavior Disorders is the only one of its kind in New England. For many students, the school is the end of a long and frustrating line. Hayden's director, Joe Scheckman.
Most of the kids that we see here at the Hayden School are the product of anywhere from 6, 7, 8, or 9 different previous placements. Combination of foster homes, group homes, day treatment programs. A number of them should have been in residential care much earlier than they were.
Money is a barrier. $72,000 a year for a student like Michelle. A hefty sum in these days of budget balancing.
But you're either going to pay for it now or pay for it later. The kinds of kids we work with, if we don't do the work we need to do with them and have the resources to do it, they're going to be in the jails and they're going to be in your state hospitals and they're going to be on the welfare rolls for most of their adult life.
The Hayden alternative is therapy to release students' anger, combined with support to build a future. For Michelle, it's working.
I get a lot of help, and I feel like I can express my feelings, and I've really come a long way since 1983. I really have, and I'm really happy with myself.
For some adolescents, for Michelle Almeida, a group facility like the Hayden School is the appropriate placement. For others, an intensive one-on-one relationship with an adult, a mentor, is a better answer.
I have a place to be. He's not going to leave me. He's not going to burn me.
Mark Nathan's been burned a lot in his young life. Al Bickham is changing that.
I like to do it because I see many times the results that I've put in to a youngster, and it comes back to me in the fact that he's doing better with his life or her life than they did before, and I get a good feeling about, well, yeah, I helped do this.
Al Bickham is a mentor paid by the agency Dare Family Services to provide a home for Mark. Not just room and board, but a real home.
He's been the most important thing in my life so far. He's been the best, like, father figure to me.
Mark was born into a well-to-do family. When his parents divorced, his life disintegrated, leading to stays in hospitals and various foster homes and brushes with the law.
I used to really do a lot of drugs and to run away from all the problems, and instead, now that I talk to Al about it, or, you know, I see what I'm doing and I have too much to look at to blow, you know.
Mark Nathan is now back in school in a special program at Newton North. He's developing a talent for woodworking and carving out a new life for himself. That's the real payoff for Al Bickham.
The work that I do through Dare Family Services, I get paid fairly well for. I still don't make a profit because it costs so much to take care of a youngster full time. It's just that idea that a lot of people have that are in this kind of program, that here is a chance to do something for somebody else.
I'm going to hopefully get my high school diploma and continue doing things around here with Al. And I don't really know where it's going to go, but I know that I'm happier and that I am doing things in a positive way instead of a negative way, and I'm feeling good about it.
Another issue in the news: should homosexuals be foster parents? We'll have more in just a moment.
According to the Department of Social Services, the financial reimbursement to foster parents is still seriously deficient. This year, foster parents average 41 cents an hour for their services.
The Department of Social Services has been the center of controversy and criticism. In part, that's because of the nature of its clientele. In part, that's because of some highly publicized decisions it's made. Since its creation in 1980, the Department of Social Services has been embroiled in a number of controversies, but none can compare with the new policy on foster care, which was adopted last August. Since the new policy all but rules out gay foster parents, it has created a storm of protest from gays and lesbians to many foster care professionals. The new policy requires DSS to ask potential foster parents their sexual preference. It tries to place children with relatives or in a traditional two-parent family setting.
What we're now doing by establishing this policy is to say to social workers out there who work for the department that we believe that they ought to go through a process of trying to find relatives or two-parent families first.
But some of Johnston's own workers say the new policy only furthers the shortage of foster parents.
There are no places to put the child. No beds. There are no gay homes, no straight homes, no crooked homes. There are no couches. There is no place to put them.
Whether the new policy was a political or public policy decision is still up for debate, leaving many to question its validity.
To me, it's a real insult to the many foster parents that we've met who have served for years taking these children into their homes and done phenomenal jobs, to suddenly tell them, I'm sorry, we can't place another child with you without the permission of the commissioner.
Child abuse was a catalyst for the creation of DSS 6 years ago. Last year, the number of child abuse cases in Massachusetts rose 20%. Public education and awareness are cited by some for that increase. Others say it is the statute allowing for anonymous complaints to be filed against alleged abusers.
They think that they can take someone to court by using this law and get the last say in a matter, for instance. And what happens is the Department of Social Services steps in and takes the child away.
In the zeal to protect children's rights, are parents' rights being stepped on? Since only 40% of reported child abuse cases are proven, DSS is searching for the answer.
Whenever you move in one direction, you have people who have strong philosophical beliefs on the other side that parents' rights are now getting stepped on. So I think we will probably debate this forever and try and get as close to the middle as we can.
The number of cases assigned to each social worker is another key issue within DSS. In 1982, federal judge Robert Keaton ordered that each social worker not have more than 20 cases. In giving his decision, Keaton broke down in tears on the bench and said, as a result of high caseloads, quote, children have suffered unspeakable injuries to body and spirit because state officials have fallen short of what they undertook to do. 4 years later, overworked social workers say the problem still exists.
The caseload right now is so high that it's impossible to do a good job, and oftentimes the client has to suffer doubly because of this. It's just not possible to do a good job.
You have to have enough time to do what needs to be done to help these families. And if you don't, we're just going to keep, well, fighting against the tide. We're never going to see a reduction in the level of abuse and neglect. All we're seeing now is an increase in reports.
Resources are always a problem with social service agencies. This year, according to Secretary Johnston and Commissioner Mataba, more money is needed for adolescent and special needs foster care, social worker and foster parent training, as well as improved medical care for foster children. Despite the problems facing DSS, some steps have been taken to improve the well-being of foster children. Six-month reviews of every case is now standard procedure. A new recruitment program for foster parents is about to begin, and closer monitoring of foster children's health care is now required. But despite all these things, most foster care professionals still believe that the number one problem facing the agency is the new placement policy. They further believe it was adopted for political rather than clinical reasons.
Let's explore some of those issues now. Joining us is Philip Johnston, Secretary of Human Services for the Dukakis administration and the man who oversees foster care services ultimately in the state. Also with us is children's advocate Jetta Bernier, executive director of the Massachusetts Committee for Children and Youth. Secretary Johnston, let's start with you on the issue of excluding gays as foster parents. How can this policy be justified at a time when there is this critical shortage of foster parents? Doesn't that just aggravate the situation?
Peter, this policy does not discriminate against or prohibit any group or individual from the possibility of becoming an approved foster parent. All it does is to set up a process which really mandates that social workers go through a thinking procedure to try to encourage the number of children who are placed with relatives first. If a close relative is not available to act as a foster parent, then we need to find out whether or not a two-parent couple, preferably with parenting experience, is available. And if that kind of placement is not available, then we go to a single-person placement. But nowhere in this policy is there any prohibition at all against the placement of foster children with any particular group or
individual. That's the written policy. But isn't it a reality that the commissioner is refusing to sign off and that gay people are, in fact, being excluded? Is there a single gay...
Now, there's not been, since the adoption of this policy, Peter, several months ago, to my knowledge, there hasn't been one such case of a gay person who has applied to be a foster parent who has been rejected by the commissioner. Now, that
so you're accepting...
No, there hasn't been an applicant who has been gay, to my knowledge, who has been seen by the commissioner. If and when that kind of case comes to her desk, I'm sure she's going to review it in the way that the policy prescribes.
Okay, let me turn to Jetta Bernier and get her thoughts on this issue, and particularly how it might relate to the shortage of foster parents.
Well, Peter, the state's policy on placing children with traditional families may have been well-intentioned, but it doesn't really reflect the reality of family life as many people know it. For example, the traditional family, which we often consider to be the breadwinning father, the homemaker mother, and two children, comprises less than 10% of the current American family. Additionally, the Family Service Association of America predicts that by 1990, 50% of children, before they reach their 18th birthday, will have for some time lived in a home in which there's a single parent. So clearly, we need to be concerned that this current policy is limiting the pool of prospective foster parents. And in that sense, it may be creating an obstacle for children rather than helping them. It seems from our perspective that the state's policy should be one which has as its major emphasis the placing of children in caring families, however those families are constituted.
Okay, Mr. Secretary, let me give you a chance to address a couple of other issues that we brought up tonight. One is this business of the Riddick case, and I know you can't discuss it. There's a gag order in effect, but we've heard child psychologists tell us that it's wrong, it's not always right to return the child to the biological parent, that in fact that can be harmful, that a foster setting sometimes is a better setting as a permanent home for the child. What about that?
Well, I think that in some instances may be true, but I think that the law is very clear on this and the policy of the department is very clear that in most instances, if it's at all possible, it would make sense to return the child to his or her natural family. The truth of the matter is that when we really started to tear apart the numbers within the system, we found that only 5% of our children are in fact placed in foster care with relatives, and it seems to me that there certainly are a lot more relatives, close relatives out there who would be willing and able to care for children were we to really go out and recruit them more aggressively, and that's what we're attempting to do.
Okay, another issue, and I want to ask Ms. Bernier about this one, is the budget, the request for resources. And I'm curious as to what, Ms. Bernier, you think of the Department, Secretary Johnston, and the Dukakis administration's request for this year. Are we asking for enough to do the job, in your view?
Clearly we are not. Private agencies clearly have identified that foster parents are spending an average of $2 or more a day, which translates into maybe $700 or $800 a year in expenses which are not currently covered by the reimbursement rate. I'm talking about over-the-counter medications, the costs for transportation to DSS meetings, to foster care training sessions. I'm talking about the second and third replacement of eyeglasses, the cost of a car seat, a crib.
Okay, we're running short on this one. I want to give the Secretary just a quick chance before we have to go to the next segment to respond to that you're not doing the job adequately in the budget process. You're just not asking
for
the
money. Well, we've had an enormous increase in the DSS budget during the 3 years of this administration, and there was a 10% increase in payments to foster parents just this year, and we'll have another one next year. But working closely with the legislature and with groups like MCCY and other advocacy groups, we're going to continue to do the aggressive recruitment of good, caring foster parents that is so necessary to making this system work in a way that's going to really benefit troubled children.
All right. Thank you, Mr. Secretary. Thank you, Ms. Bernier. In a moment, making a difference in one person's life.
Children can have a profound effect on them, but sometimes foster children can also have a profound effect on the family that takes them in. Here's the story of what happened to one foster family.
I think we just felt we had enough love in our family to take another child. That when you have five kids, what's one more?
Paula, I was going to have fettuccine. You didn't like that.
I don't like that either.
It hasn't been all rosy. There have been problems, but nothing that couldn't be handled.
I don't think we thought that taking a foster child into our home was going to be as much work. And when I say work, I mean emotional work. And I just thought maybe we were very idealistic about it.
Stephen Marshall came to live with Carol and Mike McManus 4 years ago when he was 15. Since the age of five, Stephen has been moving back and forth between his mother's home, foster homes, and the Italian home for children in Jamaica Plain.
Yeah, my mother was an alcoholic. That was basically the reason why she couldn't take care of herself or me and my brothers and sisters. My father was an alcoholic also. He'd get drunk and he took his anger out in abusive ways. And he used to beat the hell out of my mother. He used to beat the hell out of me.
Stephen had just left two unhappy foster placements. He was anxious about coming to live with the McManuses.
I was pretty nervous. I tried to fit in because I wanted to fit in. I wanted to be part of the family.
Paula McManus.
You know, like the first month when he was living us, he was like trying to be the perfect person and always helping out. And then after that, he like put you through a test period where, you know, he's really mean, and it's like a test on us to see if, you know, we really want to keep him and stuff.
We didn't know that he had all kinds of emotional baggage that he was carrying with him for all these years, and that we were going to be the brunt of him working it through.
Everybody in this house seemed to be good at everything they do. Both Mike and Maureen, they were super in sports, and Jimmy was a sports player. It's like I could never keep up with them, you know. They were much better. I always thought they were much better.
Carol and Mike expected Stephen to have trouble adjusting to their family, but they were surprised when their children had trouble adjusting to Stephen.
I really didn't think it would affect them at all, right? And after a while, we realized some of the effects that was having on them. Yeah, I guess it really did bother, you know, especially Debbie.
Sometimes, though, it aggravated me when my father was kind of afraid to discipline Stephen. He wouldn't, if Stephen did something, and we'd say, like, I can't believe you didn't do anything about that, because if we did that, we'd get killed for it.
I tried to explain to them that, first of all, Stephen didn't have the same start that they had, that they have been with us from the beginning, and he wasn't, that he wasn't used to being disciplined. He would fight authority every inch of the way. We certainly disciplined him more than probably he was ever disciplined before. He just had to take out a lot of abuse on us.
At times like that, my brothers and sisters were like, get to hate me, because I get away with something that would not be allowed at all.
So maybe they took that as we were treating him different, and yes, in a way we were, because otherwise we would be fighting with him 24 hours a day.
The McManus children usually do their homework together around the dining room table.
He was never used to doing homework. He was never used to doing well in school, so he really needed a lot of help, and he still does at times.
Some of the hardest things for me was always having the feeling that my brothers and sisters were so much smarter than me.
Mercury nitroxide, I don't know, I've never heard of that before.
What is it?
I'm making up new elements.
Stephen never got anything but D's or F's in school. He now gets A's and B's, mostly. When Stephen graduates from high school, to me it will be the greatest achievement, even more than our own children graduating from high school, because Stephen had to come so much further.
How many? We have good times and bad times, and sometimes they're really bad, sometimes they're really good.
What do you have?
I got a full house.
I have sympathy for Steve, because I know what he's probably been through in his life. But it's tough to accept someone into your family.
For our kids, even though it's been really difficult for them, I think that it showed them that everybody doesn't have the nice life that they've had.
Is this dirty?
Yeah, of course it's dirty.
Oh, looks clean.
You know, somehow in my heart, I know we've done the right thing. For ourselves and for Stephen. We've showed Stephen how a family can be, and that hopefully that he'll want this for himself.
You get out of here.
Yeah, no, come on. In the kitchen, buddy.
There are a lot of things that I could picture myself passing on from this family to my kids.
The first year he was with us, he grew like 6 inches and put on like 25 pounds.
I'm not sure about this theory, but she says that the reason why I grew is because I'm in a family with love. You know, she says it's through love that you grow.
We've learned that more than anything else, the system needs foster parents. If you'd like to become one, contact the Division of Social Services at 1-800-345-4343. Open your home for those who have no place to call home. Thanks for being with us tonight. I'm Peter Mahigan.
And I'm Mary Richardson. Good night.
Them that's not shall lose, so the Bible said, and it still is news. Mama may have, Papa may have, but God bless the child that's got his own. That's got his own. Yes, as the strong gets small.